Welcome to the Infinite Imaginarium, where your digital dreams get turned into reality. Let your mind go, and go deep, deep, deep inside the Imaginarium. The Imaginarium is a place to dream up a new story for humanity. There's a new story waiting to be told. It is a story of human possibilities, what people are capable of doing when we come together. Many of us carry the story inside of us and are afraid to speak it. We tell ourselves we are crazy, but in fact we represent a new sanity. The ideas and practices that can create a future worth living. It is our stories that make sense of the world. If you have no frame of reference, your eyes can't tell the difference, and neither can your brain. The point is that the world we perceive isn't actually the world itself. It is our story of the world based on our knowledge and what we have learned from others. The world has no meaning by itself. We supply the meaning. Bill, it's good to have you on Infinite Imaginarium.
Great, yeah, thanks for having me. I love the Imaginarium. Best. It's a true grassroots minds. It's a true grassroots minds. It's a true grassroots minds, that's for sure.
The way hackers and other computer enthusiasts and ravers and old school punkers and bloggers and Burning Man attendees will work and play and put in their time and money and do something, not because there's potential for profits or rewards or honors, but out of sheer enthusiasm, indicates that there's something about human beings that goes unrecognized in both capitalist and socialist societies. The amount of autonomy, a certain permission to put in some creativity into their work, a certain shared sense of community. People will do all kinds of stuff simply because it's engaging to do so and can be shared and should be shared. It may indicate a future beyond robotics. Developments in nanotechnology and so forth emulate most forms of tedious labor. You're traveling into another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of ideas. You unlock this door with a key of imagination. A journey into a wondrous digital landscape whose boundaries are that of the imagination itself. Bill, it's good to have you on Infinite Imaginarium, and we've had a huge update. And I guess maybe just tell everybody a little bit about the update and everything's going on with Minds right now.
Great. Yeah, thanks for having me. I love the Imaginarium. It's the best. It's a true grassroots Minds, that's for sure. So yeah, I mean, I'm glad you guys are liking it. We've been working on it for 6 months. We completely rewrote the mobile apps with native code, so they're so much faster and have better features. And we did a whole crypto integration and replaced the whole Boost system and Wire system with an Ethereum infrastructure. And we got out of Stripe and Points, but you know, I think that obviously Points were a great learning experience, and we transferred Points to tokens. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff. We did a total like UX overhaul and changed up the way the navigation works, so it's much easier to filter through content and find videos, and we updated all the trending algorithms so that like actually the top contributors are, you know, much more clearly visible, which is huge. And yeah, I mean, I'm curious what sticks out to you all.
Actually, right now when you're talking about it, it's interesting to see kind of the evolution of Points, because I've been around since Legacy Minds, the old, when we were talking about how the new site looks, and when Nikki was talking about it, in my mind I was like, I was gonna make a joke, I miss Legacy Minds. Remember when you first updated and then like you could use the Legacy Minds for like, I think it was like a month or whatever?
Right. Yeah. No. We talked about potentially doing that with this update, but we actually couldn't because there were so many changes in the back end that they were like completely different. We couldn't have two versions coexisting.
Yeah, but it's kind of funny because I think this update took the fastest for me to like get used to it. You know, like every time something changes, you're like, this is different. But then like later when it took me like within like the hour, I'm like, oh, I like it better. But like, I remember the first transition, I was like, I kind of want to use legacy mines. But this one, it was like, after I was done posting stuff,
I know.
I'm done.
There's always that resistance to dramatic visual change. And I think that, you know, you get used to something and it's just comfortable. But we were really careful to only make changes that just made it so much easier to navigate and made it much more intuitive. So I think that, you know, visual things, probably the peak thing in visual demand is more of like a dark mode. I think that is really just the, you know, some people like more dark navigation, some people like it light, which we want to do at some point. But, you know, other than that, I don't think you can really argue with how much easier it is to filter channels, videos, images, blogs, groups, newsfeed. It's just like way easier.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess there's like one thing, maybe hopefully you could clarify it a little bit. How the points or the token is valued. I noticed that equation you did. So it's the overall total of traffic on mines at that given time?
Yeah, so first of all, right now we're on the Ethereum Rink B testnet. We're not actually on the main network. So these aren't like quote unquote real Ethereum or ERC-20 tokens yet. But the way that the rewards work now, it's more of a contribution economy. So based on your relative contribution to the whole network that day, in terms of votes you receive, comments you receive, shares, if you go to your wallet and then click on contributions, you can see sort of the score chart. So you receive a score for votes, comments, subscribers that you receive, reminds, referrals will be coming soon, traffic will be coming soon. You receive some for checking in hourly. We're gonna be continually adding more rewards. But then based on that score, that's divided by the total score of the whole network. And then we have a daily reward pool of tokens that we're allocating. And so you get that percentage of the daily reward pool of tokens. We've been really careful to try to make sure that, I think the rewards have dramatically gone up in terms of the number of views that that people are getting. I think I'm actually curious how it's been going for you all.
Yeah, I noticed that like in when I was using it, like testing it out, and then that's what I was wondering about, like the activity on the whole site, because I got rewarded a lot like in that burst. But then, like, I remember, like, later I was using it to almost the same frequency, but at a different time that the reward seemed to be lower. You know, like, I was just thinking about, like, the activity on the site and how it's evaluated and all that kind of stuff like that. Just what I noticed, you know, just kind of, like, was looking at
the... Yeah, I mean, we had to evolve the rewards to be more based on engagement that you receive as opposed to actions that you complete, because actions that you complete like posting and stuff like that is so gameable, and there were a lot of people really abusing the system and it wasn't fair to everybody else. So, but we still did leave in some, you know, activity stuff like you know, checking in, you still get credit for, which I think is important to a lot of people. And so now it's more about designing the economy and understanding, you know, the right number of tokens to be releasing each day, what the, you know, total token supply is gonna be. These are like the token economics that we're still working on that we're hopefully gonna be releasing like really soon. Right now we're just experimenting and trying different daily reward pools, And but I think that most people who are really active and boosting a lot, as long as you're boosting a lot, you're going to be getting good rewards, because when you boost, you get more interaction on your stuff, and then you get more rewards that day. So it's really important to be boosting more. And then the other thing I should explain is this whole distinction between on-chain and off-chain token. So the deal with Ethereum is that it's a blockchain, and so that's a decentralized computing system. And if you want, when you boost, if you want to boost it on-chain, then information about that boost is going to be published to the blockchain. And then additionally, if you wire another user on-chain, then that is going to also be published to the blockchain, so that the creator and the supporter have an autonomous relationship with each other outside of minds. It's actually, this whole payment infrastructure is not, you know, on our servers. It's on a global decentralized infrastructure. And so there's so many reasons why that's a really positive thing. And, you know, it gives tokens applications inside and outside of mine.
So is that the off-chain bit that you're referring to there, Bill? You know, when people do a peer-to-peer arrangement, but it's nothing, the transaction has not taken place actually within the Mines platform, is something outside of that, but they've met on Mines and then they have some kind of interaction. Or have I got that totally wrong? So I'm not very good up on all this stuff, to be honest.
Well, you can. The reason we left in off-chain is off-chain is essentially the same. It works the same as points. So we're still keeping track of the whole synchronized token supply in the system. But off-chain just means that you don't have to install MetaMask. You don't have to set up your Ethereum wallet, and you can just handle everything in your Mines wallet. But just because, you know, cryptocurrency is pretty, you know, it can be complicated. Definitely there's a little bit of a learning curve, and some people are interested and willing to go there, and other people aren't. We wanted both worlds to be able to interact with it. So if you can still do things off chain, but we are trying to encourage people to go on chain. It's really not that much harder. Once you're set up, it's only like one extra click of a button.
Nikki, you've been able to play around with the, Did you notice that update?
I had a bit of a hiatus with my, you know, just because of stuff going on in my life. But I just kind of thought I was missing Mines a lot. I thought, God, I haven't been on Mines or been that active with Mines. And obviously, I'm still in touch with people from Mines. And I went on and I just couldn't believe that. I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. It's so, like, divine.
All right, that's
so out of touch with it. And I went back on and I was just like, oh my God, this is so brilliant. And I've just got immediately into it then, so I'm just on there posting all the time. How does the trending channels part of Mines work? You know, like when you go in to see what channels
there
are, and you're like, is there something?
So that is based on your contribution score. Yeah, it's based on your contribution score. So of that day. So this is changing trending channel changes every day. And it's based on the number of votes, comments, reminds, subscribers, check-ins.
It's kind of the whole shebang, as it were.
The whole shebang, yeah. It's a holistic.
It's to do with the whole way people interact with you, comment on your posts, the level of contribution. So you might be someone who writes blogs nonstop, or shares your artwork or music you've done, rather than someone who just shares pictures or... Do you know what I'm saying? So is it based also on the quality of the work that's being shared as well? Or?
That's really tough. Well, the way that we're measuring quality is based on engagement. Because, you know, I understand, it's important what you're saying, because obviously, you know, there's extremely high quality content that doesn't get good engagement. But for us, and rewarding, we don't have the power to, or the number of people to be able to like go through and like judge quality, and we wouldn't even want to subjectively be making those decisions.
Well, that's
it's fair. More up
that's,
it's
that's
it's
a fair yeah way of doing it, because of course you can't, it's like, you know, using art as an example, we all know that art is a subjective thing. You know, somebody might absolutely hate something, another person might absolutely love it. So that's not something that can be measured. I totally agree with you there, Bill.
Right. So, I mean, for the people who are just focusing on creation, and, you know, all I would say is just, you know, just boost. The more you boost, the more engagement you get, and you can get exposure. So it doesn't, you know, take much time to boost. And if you're focusing on creation, that's fine. Just gotta make sure to boost it.
Yeah, because I've been experimenting with like Steemit, and there became this whole issue too of like, what it's hard to evaluate like the merit of someone's posts. And I think like what Nikki was kind of saying, like, you know, you could do an image, right? And you post that up, and then you get all this engagement of it. Or you could spend all week writing like a blog and making images for it and this and that. And then you go and you post that, and then it doesn't get nearly the same activity. And I think that stuff that you put quality in, I believe those are the ones that like survive. Like they may not like make it right now, and you may have a few people, but if it's quality enough, you know, keep on like reminding it into your feed, or like what Bill was saying, boost it up. You know, it takes like one person to like spend the time and read it, and then like be like, oh, this is actually really interesting. Let me write a comment, and then you can have like a whole discussion in your comments. It needs to have some, find that person, maybe on like a Sunday was like, oh, you know, I feel like reading something, I'm tired of like seeing all these images. And then this just goes into my own strategy of like how I constantly try to refresh my own stuff. I think in the long run, if you put your effort into your material, and don't let your old ideas either die either. I think it's always good to look back at your stuff. This is just for people that are like want to create their own media. And I think that's what Imaginarium is about. But I think to help encourage people to keep on working on their media, because I think like that's valuable in like the long run. And I think, but I don't want to bring in Kevin. Kevin.
Yeah, Bill, thanks a million for taking the time out and hanging out with us on the Imaginarium. I love the feel of the platform. It's very smooth, very modern, moves real quick. And I've enjoyed it as the mobile update on my Android. It really makes a big difference in my interfacing, my ability to reach into the people. And I'm frequently inspired to, you know, throw a paragraph up while I'm doing my work day. And I can quickly jump in there and post it up. And I got to say, I'm seeing our old school people coming back online here, and I'm seeing comment culture come back in a big, big way. There's a lot of folks that are talking and throwing ideas and opening the door to, you know, exchanging these ideas and, you know, internalizing information a bit. And it's got me really excited to have everyone jumping on board. It feels like, you know, 2015 again to some extent.
Ah, that's what I like to hear.
Yeah, they're excited about the energy, and you can definitely tell, boy, we sure hit it in the crosshairs with your launch and bringing forward the white paper with this huge fallout from data breach and personal information sharing. Could you touch on that a little bit, Bill? Let us know what you're thinking.
Yeah, they definitely all coincided in a very synchronistic way with the Cambridge Analytica stuff and our crypto launch, and just generally a lot of the growth and more just insanity in the crypto world. You know, it's up and down. It's generally, crypto market is growing really fast. But I mean, yeah, I thought people forgot about privacy for a couple of years there. And then, you know, it came back really hard. And that's great. We needed that, because we've always been dedicated to, you know, encrypting with our encrypted messenger and the right to anonymity and these kinds of things. I did want to touch on one thing that Daniel mentioned, what about Steemit, and I'm curious your experience with the way the economy is set up there, because isn't it, correct me if I'm wrong, the more Steam you have, the more voting power you have. So basically, you're only earning if you're getting votes from like whales, right?
Yeah. And that's a major thing that kills their economy in my evaluation of it, or how I'm thinking about it.
because you don't get any of those payouts. The payouts it gives you, the cryptocurrency it gives you, kind of more voting power and to expand your stuff and so on, right? So you don't get that unless you get noticed by certain people. Like you could have something that quote unquote goes viral, right? It gets 1,000 views and 20 people vote on it, but they're all people that have no steam. And so you get no payout, where you could get one, like if a whale sees it, it could get 2 views with 1 like, and then it could get like 20
steam points
or whatever.
Yep, that's exactly what we were trying to avoid and sort of make it much more equal vote. And one other aspect I should mention is that it's unique interactions. So your score is not based on just, you know, you can't just go to your friend's channel and just mass upvote all their stuff. it's based on how many unique, true, you know, genuine unique people that you're interacting with every day. So, you know, in terms of, you know, Kevin mentioned common culture, I mean, that's exactly right. I mean, you know, the more unique comments, the better. Yeah, it's great to see some of the old faces revitalizing and getting new energy. And yeah, we put a lot into this one, and there's you know, this year's not even close to over.
Yeah, but it is really interesting to, and I'm glad, you know, I've seen the evolution of like the point system, and but I like what you're saying about trying to gauge those unique engagement. But it is something interesting to really keep on working on this attention ecosystem, and it's kind of hard to their feed is, you can't re-steam your own stuff, so someone else has to re-steam it. So you know, like, you can't like remind your stuff to keep it in like your feed rotation. Like, say if it's something really like, I spent a week writing this blog and, you know, I interviewed like 3 people and, you know, I put a lot of effort into this blog, and, you know, if no one's on or whatever, then it's buried. Like,
oh, you can't even bring up old posts because you can't share. I see that. Yeah, that's,
yeah. But
there's a important balance to try to strike between, you know, you don't want to exploit the attention world, and because there's, you can get, it can sort of feed into some unhealthy behavior when it's like everything is too much focused on gaining attention, and that's something that we're really thinking about from a higher level, long term. I think that, you know, the reality is that Facebook, Google, Twitter, YouTube, all of them are not giving users any attention. So the first step is to give users attention and give people the ability to reach people.
Yeah.
So I think giving away attention is actually really important. In the long term, you know, the qualitative aspect, I think, is also, you know, important to bring in thinking about sustainability. Also, like, the offline world, balance between, you know, internet addiction, these kinds of issues are something that hopefully we can get back into. And, you know, that's where the events come into play. That's where, like, what we're doing right now comes into play. We did actually a live event recently in New York City, and it was really awesome. And I want to get back into that, maybe even adding features into the app someday to sort of like help you limit your time on the phone. I mean, I'm just like, it's so hard. Like, that's one of the hardest things in the world, to discipline yourself to not look at your phone every 5 minutes throughout the day.
Yeah, that's actually one of the most more interesting parts of the Gathering of the Minds, that event that you had when I was listening to it. Mm-hmm. It is something that's kind of important about how much attention we're giving our phones and our apps and this and that. But I'm glad you kind of reiterate that. And so, like, there's no reason why we can't use these apps and also be like beneficial, you know? Like, maybe, like, we had this game, and it's called Real or Not. Like, me and Missy were just like brainstorming, and actually we were at a park and we were talking about it because she was looking at something. Is that real or is that not? And I was like, no, that's like a muffin top. And she thought it was like a mushroom. But it was like all weird. And I was like, oh, that would be kind of an interesting game to have on your phone. And then you spend like an hour on it, and then it tells you to like go out in nature. Like, what are you doing wasting your time on this app?
We can do notifications like that. I want to. I think that we could probably do that in the near term.
Yeah. It's just like, you know, like just casual. It doesn't have to be like, you know, that kind of like in your face or whatever, but you know, just, hey, you've been on for a while. Like, you know, or what's also interesting is this is actually central to Infinite Imaginarium. It's about turning this energy that Minds has helped us to gather and to turn it into like this feedback loop of doing like what you did with the Gathering of the Minds. We had talked about our van, but you know, on a small level, like Kevin's has been to my house. I've been to Lee Travis's house. You know, like I met Gus Spiders in person, and that's like something that's very small, but I would love for that to keep on, you know, growing. And it's about turning this energy that Minds has helped us to gather and to turn it into like this feedback loop of doing like what you did with the Gathering of the Minds. But I would love for that to keep on, you know, growing and expanding as far as this kind of like, okay, we have had social media, right? And basically all it's done has been kind of like have this addictive kind of casino attention without giving us really anything, just stealing our data so they could sell us like ads for like tube socks or give us fake news. But why can't we use this attention in different ways, in creative ways, in fun ways? And you know, there's a lot of different apps doing something similar to that, but there's like, that's what I always loved about mine and about having you know, this ongoing discussion with you is like, there's a blank canvas, so we could do anything with Minds. We could do anything with this social network, you know?
Minds at the beginning, in which was the thing that I really loved about it, was that it gave you this ability to connect with so many people to the point that you could actually potentially meet them in person. It gave you that opportunity rather than just, like you were saying, Dan, being on social media for the sake of being on social media, because in the end, you ask yourself the question, what is this, what, you know, why are we doing it? If we're just going round and round in a fishbowl, sharing memes, amazing blogs, but then we never actually connect with any human beings on a physical level. It's kind of like, I'm not saying that it's a bad thing that we don't always connect with people or meet people in person, but that was what I thought was so brilliant about Minds. There was that vibe about it that was different to all the other social media platforms. Almost like it hadn't occurred to people in that social media platform reality yet. In Minds, it was like this ability to connect people, particularly with the boost function. It's like that in itself is the most amazing part about it. That you can, I don't know, now we have the tokens, but that ability to connect with so many people on such a massive scale is, you know, there's never been anything like that ever. Brilliant.
Yeah, you can. I agree with Daniel that you can't really separate digital and physical. Ultimately, technology and nature are intertwined, and so it's not really, you know, we just have to be careful about not letting ourselves polarize the situation and, you know, be too anti-tech or too anti, too consumed in it. It's just like finding that flow that works. And you know, we all know at the end of the day, when we wake up in the morning, if we just, you know, you wake up in the morning, you sit on your phone for the first like hour of waking life, that's a little bit insane.
The minute your eyes open, it's like, oh, I mean, I can literally open my eyes and I can feel down to the phone, and it's like, where's my?
That's why you got to put the phone on the other side of the room.
I'm knocked it on the floor and I'm literally leaning around on the floor, like, where's my phone? Oh. Oh God, you know, literally the minute my eyes open, and I often have this thought process in myself. I think a lot of people don't even think anything of it, Bill. I think a lot of people just do it. It's the norm, it's what they do, it's what humans have evolved into, that kind of lifestyle. But, you know, a lot of us do actually think of it and think, well, you know, this is a weird reality that we're all existing in, and that we do this, but yet we all do it. And we have to embrace, you know, technology and the way the world is now.
Mm-hmm.
what we've evolved into is where we are now in the present moment. So I don't think it's a case of trying to not do it. It's just
no, there's no going backwards at this point.
Kind of going back to what Bill kind of popped into my mind, and I like the analogy that you were getting. I think central to minds what the power was, what I saw when it was social networking, site, that you used the phrase open source. So that gave me the innate thought, well, if it's open source, then that means I can contribute to it. Like, you know, co-creating and all that kind of stuff. And it makes me the person that I am to think, well, you know, that's why I started, me and Ghost Spiders would just talk about point system and like, get people are gaming it, or like, how does this affect the environment? Like, that's just like what we like to do for fun. Me and Ghost Spiders sit around and talk about the pros and cons of the functions on mines. But you know, like, people are different in all sorts of different ways. But when you say that you can help co-create in whatever small way, you know, like, there's like the bug and group channel. I remember when I first was on mines, I would troll that and just help people with simple stuff, like, oh, like, why can't I do this? And you just, because it's like common knowledge for most of this stuff, and it makes you feel good, and you maybe made a new person that you could interact with, you know. And
yeah, no, honestly, that is, I cannot tell you how helpful it is when people contribute in the support group and help us bust through those questions that new people are having. That's huge. And then for, yeah, obviously the coders, they can check out the code at mines.org. And then, you know, just generally speaking, open source applies to like all the different layers of mines. So yeah. It's the content, it's the code, it's the contribution, it's the whole thing.
Yeah, and I like your an analogy we're saying about open source is like organic food. And that makes me think too, you know, about like when you're consuming these apps and the different attentions, like I would say, I used to joke around with Corey about this, like, oh man, I can't believe I was watching too much politics. It's like eating a bag of chips. Like, it's all, like, it gets addictive, and then later you feel like shit afterwards. Like, I know it's not good for me, but I was like, oh, I'll just take a little bit of it. I'll read this one article about Donald Trump, and then it turns into like an hour and I feel bad. Just like, you know, oh, I'll just eat one bag, only one chip today, and then eat the whole bag and feel like crap. But yeah, but there's no reason why we can't use this attention to make us feel better, you know, or make us feel more energized. And that's something too that what I learned, and why I kind of like doing these kind of stream of consciousness hangouts, is that every time there's a little bit of anxiety that comes into like, oh, doing these things, but every time there's always a certain point in the conversation where you just feel better, like you feel more energized and your mind starts going again, and like, you know, you feel like, okay, like, let's do more stuff, like, this is where we should be doing it, this is where we're at. Kevin,
yeah, I
actually,
love your remixes, yeah. Man, something about the combination of music and visuals and text and just this whole like meme culture.
Yeah, this is the remix. Come on now.
Awesome, man.
Yes, I'm a kid, man. It was awesome.
Yeah,
that gets pretty real right about there.
Oh yeah. Yep. About started crying.
For real, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you start recording, Corey?
Yeah.
Sweet.
I'm in love with large bills, and down with a fat ass and wasting tall heels. Yeah, it's the tough London, 100 carats in the charm, trying to give it back to Sean.
Oh, bringing momentum back to the project and getting things going again, just because it was a bit of a hiatus and a bit of scattered on the direction of how everything was going for a bit.
I've been gone for a minute, now I'm back with the jump off. Goons in the club, case something jump off. Back up for the hive, let the pump off. In the graveyard is where you get dumped off.
All we wanna do is party. Getting by everybody at the barber party. Black Barbie dressed in Bacardi. I'm trying to leave.
So everybody's kind of hungry to start doing more work like that. This loose, decentralized, collaborative way. And so I think this is perfect for the landmarks.
We the best, still is room for improvement. Our presence is felt like a black people movement. 7 quarter to 8 back and back, and I'm sitting on chrome 7 times.
Cause that's my piece. The Bentley's on is the best.
But we still have that viral growth with Minds Bring It Back.
Yeah, I liked it, man. It was for me, it was pretty fun. So I'm just gonna keep running with it, having fun with it. See who else joins in and tags some stuff. And it sounds fun to me, man. So. As long as I have fun with it, I mean, that's kind of the direction. The only direction I want to steer it in is as long as I can keep having fun with it. And everybody involved, you know. Anything that we can do to pull in, you know, more people to participate. I think the bigger it gets, the funner it would get.
It's just insane. It's like...
Yeah.
It's such a good way to communicate information. It's so effective, whether even, you know, whether it's like comedy or, you know, politics or just art or anything.
Yeah. And, you know, I was watching this newscast thing. And so, you know, the whole Sinclair thing, it didn't go like viral until someone made that montage, right? Of all the anchors like talking over. And anyways, now everybody knows about Sinclair, but you know, John Oliver did a bit about it, and Sinclair, like, if you read, you know all about their merger and different things that they're doing as far as kind of having a bias to how they report stuff, which is besides the point, but that one fact didn't go viral till it came into everybody's consciousness, until someone did that montage and that like kind of quick little montage, and then it came into like the collective awareness.
Yeah. No, absolutely. I mean, a meme has more chance of getting something into public consciousness than, yeah, you know, an in-depth piece of journalism, potentially.
Yeah. Like, that's how the ideas... I mean, ideas, you know, the whole meme thing is about how ideas replicate and the smallest form of them. But, you know, it's so interesting discussion, but it's so interesting, you know, and it just kind of goes back to Minds. One of the first things that I latched onto Minds is that ideas are networks. And these ideas of certain things build these networks out. Because, like, for instance, the Cambridge Analytica thing, I was talking to my cousin in New York, and so we were talking about that a little bit. And the whole time that it was happening, I was like, this is stuff I've known for, like, a long time. I've been, like, ranting and raving to anybody that talked to me at a party. Like, do you know what Google and Facebook are doing with your data? Blah, blah, blah. Like, oh, there goes Daniel again, ranting and raving about this stuff. And then Cambridge Analytica, I was like, that doesn't shock me. But it was like, it was kind of cool, because then I was like, well, if you're worried about that, you could use something like Minds. You know, there's a lot of programs out there. There's a lot of interesting... even like what I've been using recently is called Brave. The browser. Yeah. And it's really nice to have it, like the browser itself have the capability to set how you want, you know, your information to be. So if you want to block all the ads, you just block them on the settings of the browser. It's kind of like by default, you know? But it's later they're going to have a crypto thing, but it's interesting how this is all becoming like the norm. You know, before it was something that only us crazy people on Minds would like talk about cryptocurrency and worried about your data getting ripped off. And then now my cousin from like New York is like trying to tell me about it. And I'm like, oh yeah, that's interesting. Like, you should check this out or that. I don't want to go all tinfoil hat on him, you know?
Yeah, you gotta kind of tread lightly and just not force feed.
definitely.
That reminds me, Bill, I just wanted to ask you, actually, just something Dan said reminded me. What, could you tell me a bit more about the upgrade thing, you know, like verified channels, what that's all about? Because is that, I sort of read up on it a little bit, and is that to do with sort of like being able to customise things a little bit more from your end, so you can say, well, I don't want to see certain boosted posts, etc., or... what's all that about? That, you know, when you pay a small fee each month, and then you have a verified channel.
It's not too much right now. We want to build it out so that it gives a lot more. But so if you go to minds.com/plus, you can then have the option to not see boosts in your feed. You can request to get verified. The only reason we do that is because we just don't have the overhead to verify just everybody. So we need people to just like become plus, and then we can potentially do that. And then, let's see. It has a number of other things. It used to give points.
Can I just ask one question about that? For example, we're having quite a lot of bigger people come on Minds now, which is really good. I noticed Max Kaiser, who's, I think, is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
Various channels, there's been some really great YouTubers coming on. So if you are quite a sort of a famous internet star or whoever, and you come onto Minds, you know, there's a potential that somebody could make a lot of duplicate channels, and presumably if you've got that verification tip, they know that you're the real deal. Is that part of
Yeah, I mean, ultimately verification is not going to be in a plus. You know, you're not going to have to pay to get verified. I think that there's probably maybe a handful of like very early users that we verified just because they were here early. But, you know, you shouldn't have to really pay to get verified. We just don't have the overhead to do it. So yeah, I mean, especially for public figures, verification's pretty important in terms of knowing if it's the real person or not.
Yeah, I think it's definitely important, because I know when you go on places like Instagram, there can be like about a million Madonna channels or something. You're like,
right,
the actual real Madonna.
The other thing we're going to add into Plus or Pro or whatever we're going to call it is just extended video. Video has become by far our biggest cost, and it's tough because it's draining our resources very rapidly, but we want obviously people to be able to upload as much video as possible, but the transcoding and bandwidth costs are extreme. So this is like the carrot that YouTube has over everybody's head, is just this unlimited free video, just because they have, you know, infinite basically data centers to store everything. And so we had to put a cap on videos to 15 minutes for now. We're looking into decentralized solutions to help have users help with bandwidth and potentially transcoding, but that's the reason for that. But we do want to, you know, potentially reward certain channels, but maybe with unlimited, and also have an option for people to, you know, help us contribute to helping us pay for it, because, you know, revenue is important for us also to stay alive.
So yeah, I'm a Minds Plus user because it means that much to me, and I think a lot of people will probably see the value in that in the onboarding process after a while. I just wanted to quickly touch on a couple of things. We're in process of building a global web presence, Infinite Imaginarium, which is fundamentally built within our Minds and subsidized through other platforms for the fact of generating exposure for artists and getting them to their clients and getting them exposure. And we couldn't be more excited about where the exchange and crypto platform can lead us into a more socioeconomic environment to build that thought form. And I wanted to ask Bill, moving forward in the blockchain, I think the affiliate program was one of the most brilliant and underused tools that you gave to your users. Can you talk to us a little bit about how that will integrate into the upgrade?
That's I'm so glad that you're saying that, because I was fighting for the affiliate program so hard for so long, and it does matter. Incentivizing people to refer more people to the network is, you know, essential. So we do, referrals are in the immediate roadmap for crypto rewards. So, and then in terms of like revenue share, every, you know, things are, the two main things that we're working on for that are, so we're working, if people come through your referral link, then, you know, you'll get the crypto rewards. And also we're gonna be bringing in Boost revenue share, so that you can actually opt in to serve Boosts on your channel, and we will just pay users based on how many views they're serving through their channel and their, you know, other assets. But I mean, yeah, it's very important. It's intuitive. I mean, the users need to be incentivized with a share of what they bring to the table. That's just the natural way that things should work.
I just opened a channel for a Minds Marketplace, and what I was hoping to do in time was get a few of us together to curate that, and as crypto becomes a part of our daily lives, get to that place where people who make jewelry, knit, you know, draw, like Adam Milwart and his artwork with his mandalas, mm-hmm. Giving these people a place to centralize their wares, as opposed to having only exposure through, you know, other channels, and give place like a mind shopping channel. I think that would be critical to us generating this open source, funding each other platform to use our social media time to generate rewards, and then also our creative personal time to make artifacts that become saleable, and have a point, you know, a peer-to-peer opportunity to complete those transactions. So I'm really excited about where that aspect is going.
Oh, that's interesting. So did you make a group called Minds Marketplace?
I did.
Okay, send me that link. Because we've been talking about, I mean, adding the ability to sell long term, we will add the ability to sell products into Wire. So similar to how people can send you tokens in exchange for rewards or exclusive content that you set. We want to add in, obviously, other sort of marketplace options. But that's a really good idea to just, let's create a group, and people can post their exclusive content in there. They can post their products in there. And even though it's not all necessarily streamlining through the Wire system right now, at least that will start to give us a good feed of great products that people are trying to sell. I mean, that's a really good idea. And then we can, we're gonna start filtering images, videos, groups, once the content supply builds up a little bit, have a filter for monetized content. So next to, you know, you can filter by top videos you're subscribed to, you know, your videos, but then also monetized videos. So you can go through, see the trending monetized content, see, you know, potentially way in, you know, in the future, trending monetized products. But yeah, let's get that group going. I think that's a really important first step.
Nice. Could I ask one more question?
Yeah, man.
How much of the cash flow business model does Priority Boost provide for the platform at this time?
A lot, actually. We actually just switched it because the Boost backlog was building up significantly, because some people were kind of dominating the Priority Boost with tokens. So we actually just temporarily switched that so that you can only do Priority Boost with dollars. And that does help us a lot with our revenue. Boost revenue is our main source of revenue. Plus is good, but it's not really that substantial. Both are key. So, yeah, why do you have a thought about that?
I was just curious, because I try to be a 50-50 user. So as much time as I spend making content. I try to get out there, engage the public on minds, and see what the, you know, what the mindset is. So I'm not trapped in a glass echo chamber in my, you know, my world the way I try to project it. But I was just curious, you know, it's important to us, Infinite Imaginarium, and I think everyone on Minds, to be the most effective at providing cash flows while we get our usership up, and bring in some of the, you know, because we're peer-to-peer advertisers, we need to build channel and brand recognition. It was important to me that you, you know, identify to us in the program how we help you make mine successful, so that the crowdsource monies don't get burnt up and run cash flows. So if you have anything more on that.
Yeah, thank you for asking that. I mean, that's the WeFunder was huge. Anyone who doesn't know who's listening, we raised $1 million from 1,500 members of the Minds community, and it it is what allowed us to build the whole update that we just spent 6 months building. And you know, we're being very bootstrapped, startup-y, and lean, not spending where we don't need to. But revenue is king. I mean, it's much better to be generating revenue than to have to raise money. So, boost, priority, if you can priority boost, if you, you know, that is a great way to get your content to the front of the line, and it helps us a lot. And also, you know, ultimately boost token revenue is going to be Minds revenue. So this is actually another main reason that we switched to crypto, because how it used to work is that the points would go out there, they were just sort of generated out of nowhere, or people could buy them, and then, but when we received the points back, that was, it was over. But now the tokens go out there, and then when they boost, at least to the full network, they come back to us. So once we go live on the mainnet of Ethereum, that's going to be epic. And you know, you can also boost peer-to-peer to other users. So, you know, as you all know, but maybe others don't, you can actually boost your post specifically to another channel and they get the money as opposed to Minds. I think that both are effective options depending on what you're going for. Sometimes you want to reach a certain creator's audience, and sometimes you want to just reach the full Minds network. So yeah, definitely become Plus user. We're going to be adding more and more features into that, and boost as much. Those are the two main things right now.
Well, and it's cheap at $5 a month, you know, one less Starbucks, and you get to keep the lights on. That's a good deal, right?
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill.
Yeah, that's some good stuff right there. So thanks for your time, Bill, and we'll start wrapping things up. Before we go, Nikki, do you have anything last you want to ask Bill?
No, I think he's been going in the right direction. For me, it feels like a new era of Minds. Yet again, it's kind of been a bit like the thing that the astrologers talk about. I feel like there's been that kind of retrograde feeling of not being able to move forward. And all of a sudden, it's like there's been this kind of explosion of activity, and it feels as though we've turned a corner and we're kind of going into a new era of creation. And it, yeah, I haven't really got anything to ask, but I would say that it's all looking very positive. It's great.
Thank you. I mean, and definitely, you know, reach out if you know any of those original Minds crew who are out there, all those creators who, you know, a lot of them are back, but some are still dormant. So we want to wake up everybody.
Backlord's back.
He's back. I messaged him. I told him about the the crypto, and he was like, "Okay, I'm coming back."
Yeah.
Well, it was really weird because I haven't spoken to him for a while. We've been just been doing our own thing, and he was like the first person I spoke to online I kind of went back on there, and like I said at the beginning of this, it was just like, "Oh my god, it's moved on so far in such a positive way." And then as I was scrolling through my newsfeed, I suddenly noticed that Tech Lords is back on. I was like, oh my god, that's got to mark something. But yeah, so I think he's going to add some valuable content and information. And I think that he might create some blogs on the whole cryptocurrency thing, you know, to help people that are beginners in that. I think that might be something to watch out for, which could be really good.
Great. Yeah, the only other thing I would mention is I also think the content is starting to rebalance itself out, and that's sort of a combination of the new trending that we have, which is really doing a good job of finding all of the content that's getting engaged with. And also, you know, obviously there was some volatile free speech issues going on over the last year, and we obviously support free speech on Minds. And so, you know, part of it involves being able and willing to be near ideas that you don't agree with, because I'm actually working on a paper right now about the evidence that censorship amplifies violence and hate speech. And there's actually like a multitude of studies that prove this. And, you know, even if you look at the whole history of prohibition generally, I think that it points to this. And then there's the tragic thing that just happened at YouTube the other day, which, you know, obviously not YouTube's fault. Like, that woman was clearly mentally ill, but she, you know, she went off the deep end because she felt she was getting censored. And, you know, there's no justification in that. And, you know, YouTube is a private company, that they're gonna do what they do. And we can criticize their policies and whatnot. There's never an excuse for violence. But the reality is that what is the culture of banning ideas on these big proprietary networks actually doing to society? Where are all of these banned people going? Well, yeah, they're going to places that, you know, unless there's a balanced community, they're going to go into echo chambers and further radicalize. So that's why, you know, we're taking, I don't know if you ever heard of Daryl Davis. I talk about this honestly too much. I'm never going to stop. He was a African-American guy who befriended hundreds of members of the KKK and got them all to leave the KKK because he, you know, engaged them. And they eventually, the good ideas rose to the top, as they tend to do. And so, you know, there's one specific study about Reddit where they analyzed hundreds of millions of posts before and after a ban on certain big subreddits with a lot of volatile speech. And okay, so they found that in the short term, yes, they lowered hate speech. Okay, yeah, if you don't allow those ideas on a platform, okay, yeah, you're gonna probably have some less of those ideas. But if you're looking at a broader global perspective, what are you actually contributing to when you do this? And I think the harsh truth might be that the censorship policies are making the world a worse place and a less safe place. So I think that's pretty exciting research.
I think, like, in the metaphorical sense, any kind of suppression or forced to suppress yourself is a recipe for disaster. You know, that metaphorical thing of sweeping everything under the carpet, I think it's just going to burst out the carpet on the basis that it's been forced under. So there needs to be a platform and an outlet for people to express themselves, even if many people take offence by that. And work through these issues that we face. So it has to be that way. I can't see any other way forward for humanity.
Yeah.
Any kind of censoring promotes fear, and then fear prevents people from talking and sharing ideas, and then we can't move anywhere through fear of backlash or what people are going to say. And, you know, that in the long run, although it seems scary that we have to talk about these things, and sometimes it's uncomfortable. There's things that crop up all the time that I sometimes feel uncomfortable about, and I don't really want to go into that, or things can provide triggers.
Yeah, and I completely agree. And it's not to say that just because you exist on a network with certain ideas that you have to engage those ideas. I mean, no one is obligated, and, you know, we're working on this as much as possible to build better muting tools, better blocking tools, you know, all of that kind of stuff. So that, because people deserve to be able to control their own personal experience as much as possible. But, you know, in terms of allowing the content to exist on the network somewhere for those who are interested in engaging that type of stuff in order to solve it or whatever they want to do with it. It's sort of, yeah, that's it. So I'll probably be publishing that next week, and I think that people will be happy to hear that, because I know that some are confused about this situation, and some people have thoughts one way or the other.
Yeah. Kevin, your last thoughts or anything you want to say?
Just have to, from the bottom of my heart, from one bootstrapping entrepreneur to another, say thank you. What can I say? As an altruist, the flack I would get on Facebook absolutely was amazing, just for trying to be kind and, you know, support positivity and expansion of those mechanisms within the human condition. And my whole experience since day one has been just incredibly supportive, very unique in the world, even in public social peer-to-peer gatherings. The audience that has come forward over the last 6 months to a year, the people who are bringing content to minds in consciousness, in awakening, and just sharing good scientific information is explosive. I can't believe what I'm reading in the timeline. I'm so happy. And for you, Bill, Ron, Mark, Ian Crosland, Jack, wow, thank you for all the hours and the effort, because it doesn't go unnoticed, and we do appreciate you. Thanks a lot.
Likewise, Kevin. This is what it's all about. So hopefully Daniel can slice this up and inject them into the abyss of the web for some positive feedback.
And maybe some not positive feedback.
Or not, yeah.
Like, one time I did a remix, because me and Gus Spies were talking, it was like, bring on the trolls. Because we're talking about, like, just different things. This was during the Kata era. And we're like, oh, great. Now we're going to get a bunch of different comments. And Gus Spies was like, bring on the trolls. I don't care. And I'm like, dude, right when he said it, I was like, this line needs to be in a remix. Like, that's it. But the motto for Infinite Imaginarium is connect, collaborate, and create. And I think what's important too with minds is that we're co-creating this network. So for everybody out there, just start creating stuff and start posting it up there and connecting, collaborating, and creating. It's been fun. Thanks, Bill, for coming on. It's always cool to catch up with
everyone.
You. And
yeah, Imaginarium. Let's do it more often.
Yeah, that sounds great.